Hi. So actually, I'm going to continue the discussion that was just going on. I apologize. So in general, so the description that Stefan gave, and actually this is something that's come down from Onyx, which was a very early SDN controller, has always been that the way SDN will need to evolve is it will need to have multiple controllers. You need this for fault tolerance and for scalability. And of course, once you have multiple controllers, they should talk through some consistency layer that makes sure that they all see the same sequence of network events. This is because if you want to do replication or you want to build replicated state machines, this is exactly the property people ask for. And for a lot of controllers today, the way they're doing this is they're using Paxos, Raft, or other coordination mechanisms, which are pretty heavyweight. OK, so the way I'm going to do this is I'm going to say that you can do better. And to show this, we built a prototype. And our prototype sort of inverts that layer a little bit. So to start with, we have these controllers that are completely independent. They immediately receive any network events that happened and immediately respond to them. We do have a consistency layer, but our consistency layer's only purpose is to synchronize events between these controllers eventually. So if something goes out of whack, it goes and fixes it. And then there is some stuff that you really can't keep inconsistent, for example, administrator policies. And we store that in a database, so all controllers have accurate information about what the administrator wants to implement. So the beginning of this is just a discussion of what we did, and then I'll tie this back to the discussion we were having. So in terms of why we did this, we wanted to get better performance. And so one way to look at performance is you want better scalability or you want better resilience. And I'm just going to claim that what we did gives you that. But another thing you might want is faster convergence. So people, when they first talk about consistency, say, oh, if all the controllers are consistent, the data plane will converge faster. And what we actually found is this is not true. So SCL is the system we built. And you can see that if you just look at time to route convergence, SCL often responds quicker than any consistent mechanism can. And this gap grows wider when you're on wide area where the latencies are much higher. And this is not magic. It's just the fundamental thing. Consensus has at minimum an RTT or two of cost. If you just account for that, you'll get these graphs. So the last talk, one of the reasons why Stefan was speaking about consistency is this notion of correctness. And consistency without, or like having fast convergence without correctness is kind of crazy. But what we did was we made our approach to ensure that, eventually all controllers will agree on the sequence of events that have occurred in the network. So somehow they all reach a state where they agree that this is what happened in the network eventually. And eventually, for any controller, if you look at what it believes is the state of the network right now, and the actual state of the network will agree. And I'm eliding a lot of details. I can tell you what mechanisms we used, but they're not very complex. But the thing is, if you have those, you can get correctness. You have to make a couple of assumptions. And the assumptions are just that the controllers themselves are deterministic. So given the same sequence of events, they come up with the same output. By the way, you need this for replicated state machines anyway. So if you say this is too onerous, we can discuss that. And you need idempotent switch updates. So if I update the switch twice with the same rules, things shouldn't go haywire. So the claim that I've been trying to make with this four-slide run-through is that you can get working SDN controllers and networks without any consistency. So why have we been looking at consistency? By the way, I only meant controller consistency. We'll come to data plane consistency hopefully later. So there are three reasons why people bring up consistency. One is correctness. You need to ensure that the flow tables and controllers are correct, and the controllers are correct. One is programmability. So we went to SDN to allow people to write these algorithms out for themselves. But if we didn't have consistency, writing out algorithms, writing out programs would be really hard. And the last one is performance, which I mentioned as convergence. So what I've shown you so far is correctness and performance really aren't affected by this consistency thing. In terms of programmability, in our system, we just took existing controller applications which are designed to operate as if they had full control over the network and were given all of the topology of the network, and we ran them. We took care of sending out the commands and everything else, but other than that, there was no difference in programming model from what is done today. Now, the thing is, you should be very suspicious of this, because we've had like decades of consistency research in other areas where people said, you can't get correctness without consistency, so why in the world are networks any different? And the difference is really comes down to this interesting fact that in what I term as networks are open world. And so what open world here means is that the truth about the network, like what links are up, what flow tables are around, or what the flow tables have or don't have, resides in the switches. And this is very different from data stores or other places where consistency has been super important, where there really isn't something you can go refer to and ask, hey, what's the current value of this thing? And the thing with open world systems is, one, you can recover the truth. You can just go query the system and get back the truth from there. And two, actually, consistency with ground truth matters a lot more than consistency within the system itself. So as an example, if all 100 controllers that you have in your network agree that the link connecting A and B is up, but the link connecting A and B is actually failed, it's not going to help you. You really want to know that the link is failed. Who cares if the controllers agree? OK, so the other part is, why is this relevant? So the thing to note here is, my advisor was on the Onyx paper, and they very strongly said you should get consistency. And you know, like, why are we shitting on that work? So it comes down to this fact that there are several sources of network updates, and there are two that I think, now that we've gone to proactive networks, that really matter. So you get planned updates, and you get network events. So planned updates, which I think a lot of the work in this field, especially in consistency for SDN, has focused on, are these things where you get a policy update, or you have link recovery, or you have the addition of hardware, while network events are cases where you're getting link failures or switch failures or other things. And the thing with planned updates is, planned updates are a very nice place. You have a working network. You want to go to another working network. While if you look at network events, you sort of are in this position where your network is broken. There's some set of people who cannot communicate with each other. You want to fix it so they can communicate. And so as a result of this difference, even the goals are quite different. So for planned updates, you want to maintain correctness during transitions. This is exactly the sort of loop freedom property that Stefan was walking over last time. But if you're on the right-hand side, you really just want to minimize time to correctness. Who cares if there is a transient loop while you're retaining correctness? Your packets would have been lost anyways. If they're lost in a transient loop or in a black hole, you're not going to find out. Yes, Nate.
So I'm happy if the transient violation is only in a degraded sense, like it's a subset of behaviors. But one can imagine situations where it's actually, where new behaviors become possible during reactions to link failures. So is your system going to prevent those?
OK, that's a great question. If you give me 2 minutes, I will get to the end of my talk, and then I will give you an answer. I don't want to dismiss you. It's a great question in general. OK, the last bit is, consistency helps when you want to maintain correctness. Consistency just adds latency when you want to go to this. OK, the other reason why we're talking about this is, for better or for worse, if you look around, networks have sort of bought into this edge core split. So the original idea of SDN was, the core of your network is implementing a whole bunch of interesting policies. That's not how networks seem to be designed anymore. Networks have fabrics which implement routing and traffic engineering, and this is where a lot of the distributed stuff is happening. And for security policies like ACLs or traffic prioritization or other things, you usually place those at the edge. The edge policies themselves are local, so it's only on one machine. And you can use other consistency mechanisms to preserve those, and you don't have to make them as expensive. Yes?
Quick question, are blue boxes like load balancers core or edge?
I would actually say load balancers are edge. But, I mean.
I think therein lies the difference in what you're about to argue, in my suspicion.
OK.
Like if you put middle boxes in the core, I think this model kind of breaks down. But a lot of work to put NFV or middle boxes, basically they are part of the network. They have tables, they have rules. It's just richer set of rules than switches.
So I'm not sure. So okay, again, this is a what is in the edge and what is in the core is a very philosophical debate. I would say even if like you look at what AT&T's domain 2.0 thing looks like, their NFV deployments are at the edge. It's at the central office. Your middle boxes or Google's middle boxes are connected to the vSwitch on your servers. I would say that's the edge. But again, it's in the eye of the beholder. We can definitely argue about that. As I said, this is speculative. I have very little time in general for this. this talk is like,
in
what?
Life.
Huh?
You mean in talk or in real life?
In real life. Okay. So in conclusion, there's actually another slide, sorry. So what I was trying to say is there's an existence proof that consistency is not necessary. And actually, the reason I wanted to give this talk was to ask precisely the question that you had in the last talk. Why? So we focus a lot on consistency, but what is the metric we should be looking at when we're analyzing the importance of consistency? And this question of should we require consistency for SDN controllers, to me, it also harks back to what the database people have been debating with ACID and NoSQL to an extent. Like, ACID gives you great semantics, NoSQL gives you inconsistency, which one do you prefer? And just in final things, like as an open question, right? So I didn't address data plane consistency at all. I was actually hoping to do this, but then OSDI was in between, so I'm sorry. But the idea behind data plane consistency, as defined by Mark and Nate and other people, was it ensures that each packet is processed according to a single consistency policy. Now, the question is, do we need data plane consistency? So we have exactly the same trade-offs here as we did for control plane consistency, and I don't actually know the answer there. Okay, now to answer Nate's question, if I have time for that. So Nate, you asked what happens in cases where you're causing sort of other effects. So for example, my fast failover that I did inconsistently might affect the TE policies that you have or something like that. So in general, when we did our hot SDN paper on CAP, the idea there that we were trying to get around to was really the only thing that's enforceable is anything for which you can get local information. Now, for the sort of effects that you're talking about, it's quite easy to make it so that my packets do carry enough information for me to know that if this is causing a bad effect, drop it. You're not doing anything worse than what would happen anyways. So if you're afraid of congestion, just mark packets that are failed over with this packet was failed over, and prioritize it at the lowest possible priority level. You can drop it or it won't cause buffering. So I think it's an interesting question, but it's possible to generally, whenever you're doing some sort of inconsistent thing, just mark your packet as saying, hey, I'm doing an inconsistent thing. If this inconsistent behavior is affecting you, just kill this packet, it's okay. So that would be my solution to your problem.
Hey, everybody. Drag lunch on, but like the property I would really want is this has been used to operate a shared data center, and I don't want my traffic to be visible to any other tenant.
Okay.
So in the case of failures and reactions to changes, it would be easy to violate that isolation policy. And I'm curious if you can use this setup to prove a strong isolation invariant for the network.
So you're afraid of side channels is how I would discover it?
Not side channels, just logical isolation.
But then, so then for logical isolation, I'm saying place the unit, that entity that does isolation at the edge. So basically the way to look at it is this is the old middle box deployment model of having a choke point. Every traffic that's reaching your service definitely went through that firewall. It'll drop it when necessary.
Okay.